This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Magnetic Girl. Author, Richard Marsh. Chapter 1. A Man. It was the most extraordinary thing that ever happened to anyone. I really hardly know how to begin to tell about it. I was doing my hair before the looking glass in my bedroom, and I could not help noticing that it was rather a curious color, though my eyes were nearly blinded by tears of rage and something else. The rage was because Lillian and Audrey and Evelyn and Doris, and Mother too, had been saying all the nasty things they could to me. The something else was because Benjamin Morgan had asked me to be his wife. There it's out. My first proposal of marriage, my very, very first, and that it should have come from him. It made me go hot all over with shame and disgust, and a most singular variety of feelings. They had been teasing me about him for ever so long, congratulating me, of course, with the most biting sarcasm, on having made a conquest at last. I am 23, and nearly 24, and no man ever paid me the least attention, until Mr. Morgan began. And I wished he had not, because they made the most dreadful fun of him and teased me more than they had ever done before, which is saying more than words can describe, on account of his being a hunchback. At least, he's not exactly a hunchback, though they say he is, but I do like to be accurate, and I don't care who laughs at me, and I'm quite sure that it's only one shoulder which is a little higher than the other. There's no denying that he is rather short for a man. His nurse dropped him when he was a baby. For years they never thought that he would live. If it were not for that, there would be nothing against him. He has a nice face. No one can say that there is anything the matter with that, with big black eyes and the sweetest smile and the pleasantest voice. He was the most thoughtful person I ever met. As generous as could be. He never said disagreeable things about anyone. I never saw him impatient or out of temper. Though he had a way, sometimes, of making you understand that he was hurt by something which had been said or done, which made you feel that you were a perfect wretch. If he had not been crooked. They never ceased to laugh at me because of Crooked Ben, as they loved to call him. It got to such a state that I grew to hate the sight of him. At the mere mention of his name, I would go hot all over. They were always dragging him in by the head and ears. Persisting, in season and out of season, in telling me how glad they were that I had some sort of an admirer at last, even if it wasn't a very straight one. That made me so wild that I would declare that he was no admirer of mine, though I could not help but suspect the contrary. Then, of course, they would go on worse than ever, saying that having a lover like that was almost like having two, because he had two such different sides to him that no one would suppose that the one belonged to the other, and that when he was my husband, I might call one side of him by one name and the other by another. I have not the very best of tempers, and when they talked like that, I would fly into such rages, vowing and declaring that nothing on earth would ever induce me to have anything to do with him, and that nothing was further from his mind than the idea of asking me, since I had given him no sort of encouragement, but on the contrary, had given him clearly to understand that I did not desire even his acquaintance. And now, in spite of all my vows and declarations, he had actually made me a proposal of marriage. If they ever came to hear of it, I might as well go into a lunatic asylum at once, because they would certainly end by driving me there. And yet I was not so sure as I should have liked to have been, that I was beside myself with indignation at the mere notion of his audacity. Though of course I was wild. But I suppose the fact is, if you never have had a proposal from anyone, in a kind of a way, it is interesting to have an offer from anyone or anything, even from, in a manner of speaking, a monkey on a stick, if only just to know what it sounds like and how it's done. Everything was against Mr. Morgan from the very start, I will own that. When he met me, I was in a red-hot rage. If a king on his throne had asked me to be his wife, I should have felt like scratching him. Mother had just been telling me that I was getting dowdier and dowdier, and uglier every day, and if that sort of remark makes anyone feel like sugar and spice and all that's nice, then all I can say is that it doesn't me. I had really gone out to get something in High Street. But the thought of what a dreary waste my life actually was made me turn away from shops in disgust, and seek the solitude of Kensington Gardens. I had scarcely gone 50 yards along the broad walk when I all but ran against Mr. Morgan. The sight of him made me madder than ever. He just looked at me. When he was near, I used to have a horrid feeling that he understood me almost as well as I did myself, and that he more than suspected that I was an ugly duckling in my way almost as much as he was in his. It made me wild, the idea of being bracketed in any sense whatever with him. I noticed what a shiny top hat he had on. I never saw anyone who wore more beautiful top hats. His taste was excellent, he was always faultlessly dressed. I was filled with a vindictive desire to knock off his hat with my parasol and kick it. I did so feel like kicking someone. There can be no real doubt that I have both a bad temper and savage instincts. But so far was he from realizing what was passing through my mind that he gave me what was unmistakably a look of sympathy. There is nothing I hate so much as being sympathized with. The thought that he was doing so made me wilder than ever. But before I had a chance of snubbing him, he began. I was just thinking of you, Miss Nora. It's a pity you were not better employed, I retorted, with a conspicuous display of both gratitude and good breeding. Thank you. Your pity is wasted. I could not be better employed. His unruffled air made me disposed to be ruder than ever, and I was just about to tell him that it was most unfortunate that he had no better occupation for his time, when off he started, right in the middle of the broad walk, in front of all the people, without the slightest prelude. I could hardly be better employed than in thinking of the woman I wish to make my wife. And you are she, Nora, will you be my wife? I was so startled, genuinely startled, that I was thrown all in a fluster. That he had had some faint notion at the back of his head I had feared, I do not mind admitting it. But that it had anything like come to a head I had never imagined. That I do protest. Still less had I supposed that, under any circumstances, he would blurt it out in that public place, and in that extraordinary manner. It was entirely contrary to my most cherished notions. I could conceive of a declaration being led up to gradually, of its taking a final form in some delicate phrase, amidst suitable surroundings at an appropriate moment. But that, 5 seconds after encountering me in a tearing temper, amidst crowds of people, anyone should ask me in a casual sort of manner to be his wife, as if he were asking for the next dance, that I had not conceived of as possible. I felt for the moment, as if I was breathless, looking at him as if to make sure whether I could believe the evidence of my eyes and ears. What did you say? I asked you if you will be my wife. Will you, Nora? Not a word about love. Not a hint of any admiration he might feel, of regard which had been gradually growing up within his breast. Not a sign of perturbation. I had read about the awkward shyness, the painful self-consciousness, with which some men approach that most delicate of subjects. There were no symptoms of anything of the kind about Mr. Benjamin Morgan. At least, he did not wear them on his exterior. His tone and manner could not have been more matter-of-fact. If he had been asking me whether I thought that it was going to rain. I was so taken aback that I hardly knew how to treat him. I tried dignity. Is this a jest? I inquired. If so, you must allow me to observe that I don't think it is quite in the best of taste. If it were a jest, it would be in the very worst of taste. But it is not a jest, and you know it. Really, he was even more dignified than I was. Had I not known it was impossible, I might have supposed that he was snubbing me on account of the suggestion I had made. As if it had not been the most reasonable one in the world. I said nothing. The truth is, I could think of nothing to say. The position was such an excessively peculiar one, that I did not feel myself at once capable of treating him with the crushing scorn which I was becoming rapidly conscious he deserved. What he imagined my silence meant, I cannot say, but though it seems nearly incredible, I am almost drawn to the conclusion that he took it to imply encouragement. The calm way in which he went on talking forces me to think it. I do not fancy we have had very happy lives, either you or I take it that we have both led Robinson Crusoe sort of existences on desert islands of our own. I am a lonely man, you are a lonely girl. I a lonely girl. Are you forgetting that I have four sisters and a mother?
No, I am not forgetting it. But one may have a host of mere relations, and yet be all alone.
Mere relations. I like the word. I began to bristle all over. How dare he speak of my four sisters, not to mention Mama, as mere relations? His assurance was increasing. I had never supposed him capable of such audacity. I will trouble you to speak of my family with respect, Mr. Morgan, and not as if they were persons of absolutely no account. Nothing was further from my wish than to speak of any member of your family with disrespect. But I think that even you will admit that, even in your own home, you are alone. It made me furious to hear him say so, even though it might be true. It was no business of anybody's how my own people chose to treat me. They had no right to even notice. Nothing is more unpleasant than to have a stranger spying on what happens to you, in the bosom of your own family. And so I longed to tell him. You are quite mistaken, Mr. Morgan. I am not lonely, not in the very least, ever. And I cannot conceive what leads you to suppose that I am. I recognize the chivalry which prompts your answer.
Chivalry, what are you talking about, Mr. Morgan? Have you lost your senses?
No, not yet. As I trust that you will afford me opportunities of proving to you. I at least am lonely. I believe the very loneliest creature in the whole world. I want you to take pity on my solitude. I am very sorry for you, if you are so much alone.
Do you mean it?
Of course I mean it. Why do you persist in hinting that I keep on saying what I don't mean? If you do mean it, really mean it, then you have made of me the happiest of men.
That's nonsense. It's absurd to say that my being sorry for you can make you happy.
It is not absurd, because if you are really sorry, as you say you are, you will put an end to my loneliness.
I looked at him, beginning to get red all over. It commenced to dawn upon me what he meant. I had not supposed that he was a master of such roundabout ways.
I quite fail to understand you, Mr. Morgan.
Is it not plain that if you are really sorry for me, you will be my wife? And then I can assure you, from the bottom of my heart, that I shall be the happiest of men.
Such insidious methods of arriving at entirely erroneous conclusions I was unaccustomed to. It was becoming momentarily plain to me that I had not known Mr. Benjamin Morgan so well as I imagined. I had supposed that he was an artless sort of person. And now it almost began to appear that he was a regular Jesuit.
I do wish, Mr. Morgan, that you would not talk nonsense. I am not feeling very well, and I can assure you that I am in anything but a mood for frivolity.
Then our moods are in sympathy. You surely do not suggest that to ask you to be my wife is to be frivolous. It is to me the most important question that ever yet was asked. The expression of your sympathy emboldens me to put it again. Nora, please say that you will be my wife.
He raised his hand and with the tips of his fingers touched my arm, out there in the broad walk before all the people. Something seemed all at once to go right through me, whether it was the sudden surprise of his touch or the strangeness of his tone, I could not say. But for the moment I felt almost inclined to cry, and to do something much worse. For one dreadful second, I was almost on the verge of making a perfect idiot of myself. It is frightful to think of such a thing being possible, but I am nearly disposed to believe that if we had been alone, and there had been nothing to divert my attention, I might have done. But just at that second I saw Lena Porch coming towards us with Mr. Champneys, and the smile which she gave made me frantic. She is Lillian's particular friend, and quite as fond of chaffing me about Crooked Ben as any of them. I could not but suspect that there might be something a little peculiar about our attitude and the way we were behaving to one another. The idea that I should allow him to make a public spectacle of me and furnish Lena with a first-rate tale for Lillian was unendurable. I became all at once so angry, so stupidly angry, that I forgot my manners altogether, not to speak of any fragments of common decency which I may suppose myself to possess, and behaved myself like the absolute little wretch which at heart I am.
Thank you. I am obliged to you for your offer, Mr. Morgan. But I do not care to marry just at present, and when I do marry, I intend to marry a man. No one need tell me that it was a perfectly disgraceful thing to say. No one could have been better aware of it than I was. I could have bitten my own tongue off for having said it the very moment afterwards. I never should have said it at all if it had not been for the horrid smile I saw on Lena's face, and my instant perception of the sort of yarn she would make all possible haste to spin. I know that that is not the least excuse, but it is all the excuse I have to offer. I could cry at the mere thought of it even now. Lena and Mr. Champniss passed on. Mr. Morgan was still. He just looked at me once, a startled, dreadful sort of look, and then he looked away, walking on by my side in silence. I seemed somehow to have caught a sudden chill. I was shivering all over. I could have beaten myself with pleasure. How long the silence lasted, or how far we walked before we spoke again, I have not the faintest notion. But I know that at last he stood still, and turned and looked at me, and there was something in his look which seemed to make my heart go cold as ice. He said, there was a quiver in his voice which made me flinch as if he had struck me with a whip. When you do marry, you intend to marry a man. I had not thought, Miss Nora, that you would have said that to me. Good day and goodbye. He raised his hat and walked away, and left me speechless, rooted to the ground, feeling as I deserved to feel, like an utter fool, like a wicked, cruel, thoughtless, idiotic fool, and worse than that. Chapter 2. Women's Voices. He never looked round once, though I stood where he had left me, looking after him till he was lost among the crowd. What people thought of me, I cannot say. And I didn't care. They must have supposed that I was a sort of Lot's wife, turned into a pillar or something. But at that moment, what other people thought of me did not matter in the least. What I thought of myself was a nightmare. I marched off home, feeling as if I would have liked to have pinched everyone I met. I passed Lena Porch, who was still with Mr. Champniss, a most objectionable person who will wear shepherd's plaid trousers, which I abominate. Lena was to blame for everything. She stood at the gate as I was coming out of the gardens. Directly afterwards, I saw that she was crossing the road. I am sure if a motor car, which almost made an end of me, had knocked her down and run right over her, I would not have turned a hair. If Mr. Champniss does marry her, I hope he'll beat her. I have a moral conviction that he is just that kind of creature. What can a man be like who lives in shepherd's plaid trousers? When I reached home, I was hot and disheveled, and all anyhow. I knew I should get it directly I set foot inside the door, that is, unless I could manage to slip upstairs before anyone caught sight of me. And I got it. Mama opened the door for me herself. We had had a difficulty with our servants. It is my belief that when five women live alone in a house together, they always are having difficulties with their servants. I know we were. The cook and the parlor maid had left at a moment's notice, or rather, without a moment's notice. Lillian and Audrey had complained about the state their things were in, as if they had been worn. Inquiries had been made, and there was quite a scene. I should not be surprised if the cook had worn some of Lillian's frocks, they had just about the same figure. Anyhow, only the housemaid remained, and she was in two minds. And as yet, we had been able to get no one in to help her, we were at her mercy. "Why, Mama," I exclaimed when I saw that it was she who had opened the door, "where's Jane?" "It's Jane's afternoon out, and of course, I should not dream of asking her to inconvenience herself to oblige me. It's the mistresses who are the servants nowadays. What a state you're in." She spoke in her most acid tones. Mama is not very tall, and rather dumpy, and though she always dresses in black silk, she never appears imposing, though she tries her best to think she does. "Why, what's the matter with me? I've been walking fast and am rather hot, that's all." "All? Haven't I forbidden you to walk fast? Are you not aware that nothing accentuates the unfortunate vulgarity of your appearance so much as heat? Your hat is on one side, your hair is out of curl, your necktie is under your chin. You look positively blowsy. I am ashamed to see such a figure entering my house. And where are the things?" "Things?" I suddenly remembered that I had forgotten all about them. I had intended to get them as I returned from my stroll in Kensington Gardens, but what had taken place there had driven them right out of my head.
I meant to get them as I came back, but I didn't.
Meant to get them as you came back.
What do you mean? Did I not send you out for them, and for them only? Surely, Nora, you have not come back without my stockings. You know perfectly well that I can't wear those shoes without them. Nothing I have will do at all, and where's my matching?
Lillian had appeared out of the dining room. She had bought a new pair of brown shoes, which she wanted to wear that evening, and it seemed that nothing she had in the way of hose was of quite the proper shade. She had given me a scrap of material, which was the shade. It seemed that I had not only forgotten her stockings, but lost the matching. She let me have it, when she became aware of the fact. Lillian is tall, and sometimes stately, and is considered smart, but she can be disagreeable and most abusive. In fact, they can all of them be that.
Really, Nora, you are the most stupid person I ever met. Some people might suppose that you could not be so stupid as you look, but I will do you the justice to admit that you appear to try your very best to be.
That was a pleasant thing to say. While I was searching about for something nice and stinging to reply, Doris came out of the morning room onto the top of the stairs, and she began.
I suppose, Nora, that you have brought my fringe nets because I simply can't do my hair until I have them. I've just torn my very last.
Then she supposed wrong because I had not, and so I told her. The bathroom door was opened, and Audrey's voice was heard. I never knew anyone for baths like Audrey. She likes to have 3 or 4 a day, with the water about up to boiling point and oatmeal in it, and there she lies and stews. What good she thinks it does her is beyond me. I am sure it doesn't make her skin any whiter. It couldn't. It's perfectly white and as smooth as satin already. I only wish mine was like it.
Is that Nora? Has she brought that ribbon for my bodice? Because if she has, I'll put it in at once.
There was no ribbon to be got out of me, neither for her bodice nor for anything else, as Eveline, who had followed Lillian out of the dining room, proceeded to explain.
Oh dear no, she's brought nothing except herself, and a pretty self she looks. Upon my word, Nora, I wonder that you can't manage to keep yourself a trifle tidy, say about as tidy as the average charwoman. Especially as you can't afford to look as if you had got your clothes on inside out. Some girls can, but I assure you, you're not one of them. Eveline is one of your dainty bandbox sort of girls. She never wears a pin. All her clothes seem to be part of her. You might live with her for years and never know that she even used hairpins. How she prevents their ever peeping out is beyond my understanding. And as for nets, they are put on so knowingly and match her hair so exactly that you would never guess that anything of that kind could have anything to do with the exquisite neatness of her hair. We can't all appear like barber's blocks and look as if our hair were sent home ready dressed with the fish every day. That was what I observed. We adjourned to the dining room, and the discussion began. How many of them we have had of which I have been the subject? No one ever seems to grow tired of them, except me.
Nora, Mama began, I must ask you not to be rude.
Your natural vulgarity, I suppose, you cannot help, but I will have you keep a guard upon your tongue when you are speaking to your sisters. I cannot understand why Providence ever afflicted me with such a child.
I thought, Mama, that was a problem which you had given up some time ago.
Unfortunately, the affliction continues. My other daughters do me credit. They were all of them beauties, that was what made it so maddening for me. I myself am not ill-looking. Mama had been very pretty, and still looked nice, especially at night. Only I wish she would not wear a transformation, which seems to me to be just the same thing as a wig. Considering that Lillian is 29, and everybody knows it, it is so obvious. I therefore cannot understand how it is that I should have a child, who is not only unprepossessing, but who cannot be induced to pay any attention to even the most elementary rules of toilet, which every gentlewoman observes. A servant would be ashamed to appear in public, in the condition in which you at present are.
Eveline struck in.
I should think so. No decent servant looks as if she had covered herself with the contents of the rag bag. Are you aware, Nora, that your belt has worked up behind, and that the hooks on your skirt are showing? And your shoelace is untied, and unless I am mistaken, your stocking is concerned about your ankle, but she doesn't mind. This was Lillian. Mama followed. But I mind. In spite of every obstacle, I have treated you exactly as I have done your sisters. But the problem becomes more serious every day. How do you suppose that I am ever going to get you properly settled in life if you persist in making of yourself a scarecrow, an absolute figure of fun? I am compelled to use such language. Oh, you needn't trouble about a trifle of that sort. She settled all that for herself. She has her eye on Crooked Ben, which is only as it should be because then they'll be a pair of figures of fun. This again was Lillian. The things she allows herself to say when she is in the mood, if they heard them, would startle some of the people who call her stately. She may consider herself ultra-refined, and I do not deny that she looks it, but I am persuaded that at heart she is almost as vulgar as I am. When she said that, it made me mad. I flew at her like a wild cat. I was just in the mood for it. You talk with a sneer, Crooked Ben. You may have had bushels of proposals. She has had heaps and heaps, but there wasn't one among the lot worthy to black his boots. As for Mr. Rumford, that bald-headed, bloated object with quack written large all over him, you may like to have him muddling about you, but I wouldn't touch him with a pair of tongs. Lillian went white. The truth is, she was nearly 29, and I suppose thought it about time to have someone for a husband, and as Mr. Rumford was showing a strong inclination to apply for the position, I rather fancy she was considering whether he would not do. He had made piles of money out of a patent medicine called Aunt Jane's Jalap, and was really not such a bad sort in his way, though just then I was anything but disposed to let her know I thought so. Eveline took up the cudgels for Lillian. They always stand up for each other against me. What a delicate way you have of putting a thing, Nora. You and your language are so in keeping. If you could only induce someone to transfer you from the family of which you so entirely disapprove, how much happier you would be, and we also. Couldn't you put the screw on Mr. Morgan? He seems to be the only chance you are ever likely to have. Do make the most of him. Let Mama ask him what he means. Look here, Eveline. You think yourself vastly superior to me. Not at all. Not while your complexion is quite so brilliant, I couldn't. Oh yes you do. But you're wrong for all that. You've spent your whole life in chasing men. I rather fancied that some of them had chased me. But I dare say it's the same thing to you. Is there anything to be proud of in that? You've devoted your whole life to men anyhow, and I don't think that's very womanly. I think it probable that you wouldn't, for reasons, my dear Nora, do use your handkerchief. There's a drop of perspiration trickling down your nose. Or is it a tear? It doesn't seem to combine with freckles. Dora struck in. When you people have quite finished, might I ask if I am ever going to have any fringe nets? I can't remain the whole day with my hair in curlers. She had it in curlers then, and very queer she looked. No one would have known her for the radiant Doris of her admirers. Nothing takes the gilt off a girl's appearance so much as curlers. Unless Mama makes me, I never use them. Thank goodness, my hair has got a curl of its own, if it is not quite in the style of the barber's fashion plates. Mama, who never thinks of being down on them for anything which they may say to me, was quick at seconding Doris' suggestion. Nora, be so good as to let me hear no more from you. Both your language and your appearance smack of the servants' hall. You will fetch the things I requested you to bring before. Then I will ask you for an explanation of how it is that you have failed to bring them now. Go up to your room and make yourself look as decent as you conveniently can and be quick about it, and not another word. Lillian stood up. I suppose I had better find you another matching. You are sure to bring something impossible if I don't. Eveline put in her word. I should say that she's sure to bring something impossible, in any case. I would rather be excused from trusting her to get anything of the least importance for me. I admire your courage. She had better not make any mess about those nets of mine, cried Doris, or things will become exhilarating. Nora, if you tell them at Morals that they're for me, there will be no mess. I suppose you have some sense. Doris, what an inexhaustible fund of confidence you have in Nora. It may be sisterly, but is it wise? Just as I was going to snap off Eveline's nose.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.